World Affairs Council of Greater Reading is the leading educational organization promoting understanding and enlightenment on global issues. I am Mike. Welcome back once again. Thank you so much for joining, whether you're a guest following along on Facebook or a member or a guest live with us here on Zoom. Great presentation today. We sent out a little homework in advance of the meeting today, so I don't know if you had a chance to check that out. I'm sure we'll all get caught up. But let's go ahead and get started to introduce our speaker today, the Vice President of the World Affairs Council of Greater Reading, Mr. David Bean.
Thank you, Mike, and good afternoon, everyone. We are pleased to welcome with us today Dr. Charles Cookchan, whose topic is From Trump to Biden, Navigating Isolationist and Internationalist Traditions in U.S. Statecraft. Dr. Cookchan is a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations and a professor of international affairs at Georgetown. From 2014 to 2017, he served as special assistant to the president on the National Security Council in the Obama White House. He also served on the NSC during the Clinton administration. Dr. Cookchan's most recent book, Isolationism, A History of America's Efforts to Shield Itself from the World, was published in 2020. He received his BA from Harvard and his master's and doctorate degrees from Oxford. Dr. Cookchan, welcome, and thank you for being with us today.
Thank you very much, David. Thanks, Mike and your colleagues for organizing this. Delighted to be with you. My only regret is that this is not in person. I've never been to Reading, so maybe I can get a rain check after conditions improve. Let me begin by giving you a quick overview of the argument that I'm going to make this afternoon, and then I'll dig down a little bit deeper before we go to conversation. I think it's safe to say, looking back at the long durée of American history, that we have been through two long eras in American statecraft, and we're now entering a third. Era one ran from the founding era until Pearl Harbor. And I see this as the era of isolationism. If isolationism means tending our own garden, expanding in sometimes ruthless fashion across North America, being avid international traders, but generally not extending our strategic reach outside either North America until 1898 or outside the Western Hemisphere after 1898. The idea was that the American experiment, American exceptionalism required focusing on the home front, avoiding entanglement in the corrupting influences of great power politics, and that foreign ambition could come at the expense of liberty and prosperity at home. That era comes to an end in 1941 with Pearl Harbor, when the isolationist voices, the America First Committee founded in 1940 to prevent the U.S. from getting into World War II, get silenced by the Japanese attack. And the second era begins, and that's the era of liberal internationalism, in which instead of seeing American exceptionalism as a justification for staying out of the world, that is running away from the world in many respects, we start trying to run the world. We enter World War II. During the Cold War, we had bases and forces in most quarters of the globe. And the core idea behind American liberal internationalism was that the U.S. would use a combination of power and partnership, its interests and its values, to create a world that was based upon a set of liberal rules and institutions and norms. In my mind, that era, the second era of liberal internationalism, comes to an end on January 20th, 2017, when Donald Trump gives his inaugural address, and he says, from this day forward, it's going to be America first, only America first, going back to 1940 in the America First Committee. And we see in the Trump era the return of a more isolationist, unilateralist, protectionist, nativist foreign policy that looks a lot like the grand strategy of 1789 to 1941. And I think that Trump was pursuing this approach because he was tapping into a strong strain of discontent within the American electorate that basically said, too much world, not enough America. too many wars, too many immigrants, too much free trade, too many pacts, too many alliances. Hey, we want to get off this train. Stop. The problem, though, is I think that Trump overcorrected. He sensed in an astute way that Americans felt that the country had overreached. But instead of calibrating, instead of creating a more discriminating brand of internationalism that would be in keeping with the changing views of the American electorate, he took a wrecking ball to the world America made. He pulled out of PACs, he insulted allies, he slapped protectionist tariffs on everybody. He questioned the norms of liberal democracy. And so I see Trump's mistakes as setting the predicate for where we are today. That is that Biden needs to correct for Trump's overcorrection. We're not going back to the liberal internationalism of the pre-Trump era. Americans aren't ready for that. They're not interested in that. Biden himself talks about a foreign policy for the middle class. It's not America first, but it's putting Americans first. And that's, I think, because he's drawing important lessons from the Trump era, lessons that suggest that we need to work hard on fixing the country from the inside out and rebuilding the foundations of American internationalism. So that's the kind of quick and dirty version of the message that I want to share with you this afternoon. Let me drill down a little bit on each of those dimensions, the three eras, and sum up with a few thoughts on Biden's agenda and what I see as his priorities. So for starters, it's important to keep in mind that the America that we have grown up in is not the America that existed before Pearl Harbor. And I have to say that when I started writing this book that I published a few months ago and began reading about the founding era and the 19th century, my head kind of exploded because the America I was reading about bore such little resemblance to the America that I was growing up in and that I knew as a practitioner and a scholar. George Washington in 1796, in his farewell address, put it rather succinctly. The United States should have commercial relations with everyone and political connections to no one. In other words, we should not ally ourselves. We should not reach out strategically. We should focus on North America and becoming an ascendant in our own neighborhood while avoiding entangling alliances, to use the phrase that Thomas Jefferson used. And just to drive home how strong this impetus was, a few years before the farewell address in 1793, Washington committed a bald act of perfidy, which most Americans don't know about, but let me tell you the story quickly. In 1778, after the War for Independence had begun, we're losing. To put it bluntly, we're getting our butts kicked. And the founding fathers basically started off saying, we're not going to look to allies for help. We don't want to hitch our wagon to anyone else. But by 1778, they said, you know what? If we don't ask for help, we're going to lose. So they reached out to the French. They concluded a formal alliance with the French. The French came across the Atlantic with arms and ships and troops, and they helped us prevail. And we probably would have lost the Revolutionary War without the help of the French. 1793, a few years later, war breaks out between France and Britain. And the French reach out across the Atlantic to George Washington, and they say, well, we have an alliance. It was formed in 1778. We pulled your chestnuts out of the fire. How many troops, arms, ships, money, what are you going to send our way to help us? What does George Washington do? He issues the Proclamation of Neutrality, in which he says to the French, good night and good luck, you are on your own. It caused a huge constitutional crisis because Jefferson and others said, you don't have the right to renege on an alliance, it's a Senate prerogative. But nonetheless, Washington effectively annulled that alliance, refused to stand by it. And that was the last alliance that the United States had until after World War II. 1793 until the late 1940s. That's a long run, but it gives you some sense of how hard over the founders and their successors were about avoiding entanglement abroad. That ideological commitment to focusing only on North America and the Western Hemisphere came, as I said, from a sense that ambition abroad would come at the expense of prosperity and liberty at home. Americans were obsessed with liberty. They wanted to avoid a large standing army and standing navy. That's why most of our wars were fought by the state militias, not by a federal force, because Americans didn't want that. They didn't want to take that risk. There was also a sense of profound protection of sovereignty, jealous guarding of sovereignty. We don't want to hitch our wagon to anyone else. It could hem in our room for maneuver. There were strong racist elements to isolationism. We expanded westward in step with white settlement, but when it came to debates about the annexation of Cuba, Haiti, West Indies, Hawaii, big chunks of Latin America, the answer was always no. And one of the main reasons it was always no is we do not want to bring more non-whites into the body politic. We have enough trouble dealing with the non-whites that we already have here, both in the pre-Civil War context, where North and South couldn't agree on whether new annexations would be free or slave, and after the Civil War, when Reconstruction was so fraught that neither Northerners nor Southerners had any interest in increasing the population of non-whites into the United States. There were also pacifist elements. New England was strongly against the use of force. Many New Englanders opposed the Revolutionary War, the War of 1812, the Mexican-American War, in which we grabbed a big chunk of land from Mexico. So for all these different reasons, everyone found something to like in the avoidance of great power entanglement and in tending our own garden. We made two temporary detours, one in 1898, when President McKinley took the country to war to expel Spain from Cuba, and the United States went on to occupy Cuba, Puerto Rico, Hawaii, the Philippines, Guam, Samoa, and the Wake Islands. A terrible insurgency breaks out in the Philippines. Americans say, what the hell's going on here? You told us we were going on the road. We were taking manifest destiny on the road to save Cuba from Spanish oppression, and now we've turned into an empire. No, thank you. Then Woodrow Wilson tries an idealist justification for internationalism, and he goes to war in 1917, enters World War I to save the world for democracy. Well, that doesn't work either. Americans turn against the war. Three votes in the Senate in 1919 and 1920 kill U.S. participation in the League of Nations, and that begins the long run of interwar isolationism. Isolationism, in many respects, served the country well. It allowed the U.S. to rise in unmolested fashion over the 19th century, but it also took a dark turn in the 20s and 30s, when the United States ran for cover, stuck its head in the sand effectively, while fascism and Nazism grew in Europe and in Asia. The view was that we could cordon ourselves off from such trouble, that we could avoid entanglement in the evil that we saw spreading. But as we now know, that didn't prove to be the case. The Japanese brought the war to the United States in 1941. I'm going to skip over most of the 41 to 2017 period because we're quite familiar with that. It was what we're taught in school. It's the world that we grew up in. It's Pax Americana. As I said, it's the era in which, for the first time in American history, centrist Democrats and centrist Republicans come together in a compact behind a combination of American power and American partnership. And that generally serves the country well throughout the Cold War and into the 21st century. I think trouble begins after the fall of the Berlin Wall. And that's when I begin to see the outlines of what I would call American overreach or liberal overreach, in which the United States, guided by some public intellectuals, thought that history was over, that we had won, that we could fling open the doors of NATO and the European Union and our markets to free trade. Russia joined the G7, China joined the WTO, we expanded NATO, we expanded the European Union. We thought if we just fling open our markets, everybody's boat would float up. Then 9/11 comes along, and we start a 20-year effort to turn Iraq and Afghanistan into Ohio. As we now know, those wars did not go very well. And that is really the setup to the Trump era, in which Trump basically says, I get it. I hear you. You think that we've got too much world and not enough America. I'm going to fix that problem. Many people saw this as a bolt from the blue, but it wasn't. It was in many respects a return to the isolationist, unilateralist, protectionist, and nativist dimensions of American statecraft prior to World War II. I don't think that Trump read a lot of American history. I don't think that he created this alternative because he knew so much about America's past. But I think Trump did have an astute, refined political sensibility that enabled him to tap into and sense this broader discontent in the American electorate, particularly in what we call the American heartland. And he rode that to success in a way that I think is quite instructive about the country's politics today. That brings me to the final set of comments that I wanted to make, and that is, where are we now? As I said, I think Biden needs to correct for Trump's overcorrection, and he has begun to do so in important ways. Two important ways come to mind for starters. One is that he has brought the United States back to being a team player. And for me, Trump's biggest mistake when it came to grand strategy was unilateralism, pulling the U.S. out of the Paris Climate Agreement, out of the World Health Organization in the middle of the greatest health crisis since 1918, 1919, insulting allies, denigrating the idea of international teamwork. We now live in a world that is irreparably, irretrievably, inescapably interdependent. The idea that we can go it alone and solve the big problems of our time is folly. Biden gets that, and he's bringing the United States back in to be a catalyzer of international coalitions. The second area where I think Biden is making critical corrections is on democracy, human rights, American values. Even though the founders counseled against entanglement abroad, they were committed to the role of the United States as a beacon of democracy and as an exemplar, as a country that others would look to model republican government, the rule of law, political civility, common sense. That disappeared during the Trump era. Biden is trying to bring it back. And I think it is very important to have in this world, at a moment when illiberalism is on the rise in many quarters, the United States back at its game of being a country that stands by liberal values, the rule of law, constitutional government. Without our role as that anchor, I really do fear history would go in the wrong direction. There are three areas where I think Biden is in some ways, even though he wouldn't say this, taking a page from the Trump era and drawing lessons from that era about the need to focus on the home front. And I think that when Biden talks about a foreign policy for the middle class, when he focuses on investment, on pandemic recovery, on job and worker retraining, on health care, on child care, basically he understands that we have lived through a near-death moment for American democracy. He doesn't want to call it America first, but I think he is focused on repairing the country from the inside out and trying to rebuild the foundations of political centrism and moderation. It's not going to be easy because he does not have support from the other side of the aisle. I think one of the key questions on his agenda right now is, what is he going to do about the filibuster? How is he going to get through Congress the investments in the domestic economy that he thinks are necessary? I don't know the answer to that question, but I think it's looming. My guess is he's going to do his best to get Republican support. And when that support doesn't appear, he will look for other ways to get it through Congress. And he doesn't have a lot of time because the midterms are looming on the horizon in about a year and a half. He also faces the problem, and we know this today, of trying to keep a focus on the domestic front at a time when the world won't let him focus at home. There is a war going on between Israel and Gaza. There is trouble afoot with Russia and China. It's very difficult to keep his narrative on the domestic agenda at a time when the world needs American power and American attention. I think Biden has generally done a good job of striking the right balance, but like Obama found out, I mean, Obama ran on a bumper sticker of nation building here at home in his reelection, and it didn't work because the Islamic State came along. He was dragged back into Iraq. Afghanistan was a mess. Biden has made the tough decision to get out of Afghanistan, to end combat in Iraq. Trouble will follow. But I think he's doing the right thing by keeping the United States back so that he can focus on the home front and rebuild a foreign policy focused on the meat and potato issues of Europe and Asia that I think most Americans support. Most Americans do not support continued engagement in the forever wars. That's one area where Republicans and Democrats agree. So I think that number one, home front. Building support for internationalism from the inside out is key. Foreign policy for the middle class means trade that works for more Americans. Second, retrenchment from the Middle East to focus on the big ticket items in Europe and Asia. And then the final issue that I will mention, and I think it's one that Biden is going to be grappling with in the days and weeks ahead, particularly because he's about to head to Europe for his first foreign trip, a meeting of the Group of Seven. He's going to have a summit with Putin. He's got big issues on the table when it comes to China. Will he focus on teamwork among democracies and call the 21st century a big clash between democracy and autocracy? Or will he take a more pragmatic approach? For me, he needs to be pragmatic. For me, it would be a mistake to draw a new ideological dividing line and say we need to create a democracy of alliances to stand up to autocracy. I think the big challenge of this century is going to be finding ways for democracies and autocracies to work together. We cannot put China back in the box. It will soon have the world's largest economy. It is in Africa, in Latin America. Belt and Road Initiative is coming. Going back to a Cold War two-block structure in which we have fragmented economies, fragmented geopolitical blocks, it's not going to work in the 21st century. And so I think that one of the key challenges facing Mr. Biden as he navigates the isolationist and internationalist traditions in American statecraft is figuring out how to rebuild democracy from the inside out, how to make sure that American democracy and that democracy in Europe and Asia is alive and well, but at the same time, reaching across ideological dividing lines. Because if we're going to solve climate change, pandemics, cybersecurity, cyber misinformation, extremism, North Korea, Iran, we're going to need the help of China and in many cases, Russia. Those are the facts. It's not going to be easy, but it seems to me that's one of the key challenges facing the new president. I'm going to stop there and look forward to the conversation.
All right. Excellent presentation, Charles. I look forward to digging into this a little bit more deeper, a little deeper with you, more deeply. We'll talk about this more. And first, we get a couple announcements from Saul. I will remind our guests and members here on Zoom with us to start getting your questions in. We've got a couple starting to come in. If you've got a camera and microphone and want to come ask your question live, you're welcome to do that too. Just raise your hand to get my attention and I'll try to help coordinate that. But with a couple quick announcements, the president of the World Affairs Council, Dr. Saul Lausch. Who I don't see yet. You there, Saul?
I can see his picture, but he seems frozen.
All right. We will give him another chance in a few minutes. We can go ahead and get started here with the Q&A. I guess I'll just mention as we get started here that we do have our WAC Trivia Live event tomorrow evening, 7 p.m. If anybody's interested in participating in that, you can check out whackwriting.org/trivia, get the connection details there, and we'll also be sending out a reminder email tomorrow. So early question here from Andre Bury, one of our members here in chat. When you talked about isolationism running from the founding up until about 1941 with Pearl Harbor, he just asked for clarification, I guess. The U.S. was also involved in World War One. Was that not a move into the world affairs at times well before World War II?
Yeah, it's a great question. And let me just caveat my characterization of American history as isolationist, because many historians would disagree. They would say, well, we were a trading nation from the beginning. We had missionaries everywhere. We had diplomats in various countries. And after 1898, we were mucking around in Latin America, lots of intervention. And so my main point here is that we generally focused at home and didn't extend our strategic reach in an enduring way. As I mentioned in passing at the outset, World War I was an aberration. Woodrow Wilson contravened the founders, who said, stay out of Europe, do not engage in the European balance of power. But when German submarines began to sink American ships in 1917, Wilson said, we need to go to war. We need to defend a rules-based system. We need to defend the right of neutrality. And as I said, it was a very idealist justification for war. It was about defending the rights of democracy. It was about defeating Prussian autocracy. It was not really about American interests. And then at the end of the war, he tried to sell the League of Nations to the country and failed, in large part because of a mixture of isolationism and unilateralism. The Republican Party at that point had some very serious isolationists that were called the irreconcilable faction, but many of them were internationalists but profoundly unilateralist, in some ways resembling the party that we have today. And as a consequence, they objected to the United States participating in any kind of organization that would commit the U.S. to international action. So Wilson then says, well, I wasn't able to convince Republicans. I'm taking my case to the American people. And he says the 1920 election is a referendum on Wilsonian internationalism and the League of Nations. And he gets Jim Cox, governor of Ohio, to run as the Democrat. Senator Warren Harding is the Republican candidate. Warren Harding's platform is, I stand for the policies of George Washington. I am against Wilson and entangling alliances. What happens? Warren Harding wins in the most lopsided election in American history. In other words, there was a wholesale rejection of World War I and Wilsonian internationalism. And then the Senate forms a commission to say, what happened? It said, well, we were taken to war by the military-industrial complex. We're never going to let that happen again. And that was really the foundation, the platform for the hardcore isolationism that we saw in the 20s and 30s.
That, Deborah asks, and I don't think we can actually answer this question specifically, if Japan hadn't bombed Pearl Harbor, how would World War II have turned out in the post-war world? But I guess I would say, just like Trump's move back towards isolationism was a reflection of the appetite at the time, how much of the U.S. getting sucked back into that participation away from was directly because of Pearl Harbor and that necessity versus kind of a developing appetite at the time to move more in that direction?
Yeah, it's a fascinating issue. There is a school of thought among many historians that Roosevelt, beginning in the late 1930s, was really trying to get the country into the war through the back door, and that he would eventually get us there. I actually don't share that view. I think that Roosevelt, after 39, with the fall of first Czechoslovakia and then France, the formal outbreak of World War II, thinks that he needs to help Britain defend itself, because if Britain falls, then eventually the Nazis are going to come across the Atlantic and threaten the Western Hemisphere. And that's when he begins to introduce what's called cash and carry and then lend-lease, which enables the United States to provide arms to the victims of Nazi and fascist aggression. But I found no evidence that Roosevelt was actually interested in entering the war. And as a consequence, had the Japanese not bombed Pearl Harbor, I'm not sure the U.S. would have ever entered the war. Would the Germans have stayed in control of some of Europe and the Japanese and large parts of Asia? I'm guessing eventually not, and that's because both countries were spinning themselves out. The Nazis made the mistake of Operation Barbarossa, opening a second front against Russia. That ground the Nazi war machine into the ground. The U.S. was supplying, as I said, parties. But it's obviously an interesting question. But, you know, for our purposes, I think it's really important to keep in mind how strong the isolationist sentiment was. In 1941, before the Japanese attacked, 80% of the American public was opposed to entry into World War II. 80%, that's a big number. And that says to me that today we need to listen to the American public. The American public is saying, hey, we want to ease off. I think, as I said, Trump heard that and he went too far. Biden, I think, needs to find the middle ground. He needs to step back, but not step away. He can't go back to doing too much, but he also can't do too little. And so in some ways, I'm looking for the Goldilocks solution here, and that is for Biden to find that sweet spot that can enjoy the support of the American public, doing enough, but not doing too much.
Yeah, and in your article that you shared before the presentation, you talk about how he's positioning it as a battle between democracy and fascism, and kind of setting that up as the red line in the sand, which kind of, I think, harkens back to the rallying cries of spreading democracy that we heard in 2003 as justification for going into some of those wars. That now, 20 years ago, but if we look at in terms of internationalism, right? The Marshall Plan, probably pretty successful. We were engaged internationally in a way that really helped some of these countries that we had conflict with. Germany, Japan, helped to rebuild their economies and put them in the position they're in today to be, you know, world powers. Did we learn the wrong lesson from that? Or what was the bridge between then and the idea of spreading democracy versus helping other countries through these efforts?
You know, in some ways we are, Mike, suffering from our own success, in that we did help rebuild the rest of the world after World War II. And we have contributed to the Chinese miracle in the sense that China's entry into the World Trade Organization, Chinese entry into supply chains and manufacturing help us understand how China has emerged into the world's second economy, in which it has brought hundreds of millions of people out of poverty into the Chinese middle class, and in which we now have, really for the first time in American history, a peer. And I would remind everyone that the Soviet Union topped out at around 55% of American GDP. It was never a serious contender. It never was able to turn the corner on innovation and a competent political system. In China, I think we have a country that is a full spectrum competitor, and we need to come to terms with that. Do I think it was a mistake to invest in a countries abroad and to look to free trade? I don't. I think in broad terms, it has benefited the world. And the more prosperous the world is, the more stable it will be. But as I said earlier, I think we need to figure out what it means to be in a world that is multipolar. That is to say, there will be multiple poles of power and ideologically diverse. I think our biggest mistake in some ways, Mike, was assuming that as China became more prosperous, it would start looking like us. That is to say that it would democratize, that middle class prosperity would equate to democracy. That's not happened, and it's unlikely to happen. And so I think we do have to figure out, what does it mean for the United States to be in a world in which its major peer competitor is not a democracy? We haven't faced that before in the same way, and it's I think a core question for the Biden administration and whoever comes next.
Could this isolationism of this third era have compounded Chinese growth? Knowing they're undertaking this Belt and Road Initiative, did we create a vacuum for them to accelerate that we're now even stuck trying to deal with from a weaker position?
You know, I think that we are in a world today in which there is an undersupply of global governance, an undersupply of global goods. And it stems in part from what you said, and that is an American retrenchment. You know, for many, many decades, if there was a fire out there, Uncle Sam would ring the alarm and send out the fire trucks. That's no longer the case. In fact, we're heading in the opposite direction. We are bringing the fire trucks back into the firehouse, right? We are leaving Afghanistan, despite the fact that Afghanistan is burning. It's a decision that I support, but it's a tough decision. It has moral, it causes moral compromise that we all have to face. But I do think that the alternative to this kind of paced retrenchment is isolationism. If we don't get ahead of the curve and find a brand of American engagement that enjoys the support of the American people, then I think those people calling for an American retreat will win. I think that you know, the next Donald Trump will come along and withdraw from NATO and pull US troops out of Korea and Japan. And for me, that would be a big mistake. So I'm against isolationism, but I'm for what I would call judicious retrenchment, staying put in a way that enjoys the political support of the American people. But that does require being more sober about what we do and what we don't do. Is China to some extent filling that gap? Yes. Is Russia to some extent filling that gap? Yes. Who's now running Syria? Russia. Who stopped the war between Azerbaijan and Armenia? Russia peacekeepers. That's just the new world that we live in, and we got to figure out how to cope with that.
And the effort to bring Iran into Afghanistan, just that we're going to have to deal with some of these partners who we may not ideologically be on exactly the same page with. Makes sense. Some of these questions, like I don't want it to be about like a counterexample, but in this period we were this, and in this period we were that. But Andre Bury, who we heard a question from earlier, does ask, the Trump administration did negotiate substantial improvements toward peace in the Middle East, particularly for Israel, which seems counter to the argument of isolationism printed here. I guess I would maybe just rephrase the question to ask, how were those distinctions made? How does that fit into the ideology?
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to be completely dismissive of Trump. You know, I was not a big fan of the president, but I think he number one, called our attention to the domestic issues that desperately need our attention. And he did have some significant successes, particularly in the Middle East, where the breakthrough between Israel and a number of Arab countries was a very big deal. So I think we need to give credit where credit is due. I do think that his instincts were what I would call neo-isolationist. That is to say that his demeanor, his rhetoric, his inclinations resonated with an earlier brand of American statecraft in which he was basically focused on tending our own garden and focusing on American sovereignty and getting out of international teamwork. And that to me is in many respects, as I mentioned, the biggest cost, and that we now face so many challenges that can be resolved and addressed only by cooperation with others. And so the sort of go-it-alone attitude that he took, I think, was very self-destructive. But yes, he did make significant progress in the Middle East. And I would also point out that he and his team negotiated an important breakthrough between Kosovo and Serbia, getting economic normalization there. So he did have some significant successes.
I'm interested in the motivations and incentives. One of the comments you made was that ending the forever wars was something that Republicans and Democrats agree on. However, our representatives don't appear to necessarily be on the same page. And I think to some extent we see this even, I'll just use the Republican Party specifically as an example where majority of the population agrees on things like gun control, at least, you know, universal background checks, whatever. Issue by issue, there are things that most American people agree on, but 100% of the Republicans or 100% of the Democrats are firmly on one side or the other. Doesn't feel very representative. So to the statement of, you know, most Americans want to end these forever wars, how do we reconcile that against what we see in the House of Representatives, the Senate? Are they financial motivations? Are they ideological motivations? Like what, why does it still seem like there's a gap there?
Well, I think that there are lots of different things going on, but in general, what we've seen is the hollowing out of the country's political center, its ideological center, with a Democratic Party that has tended to move further to the left, although still has some centrist members, I would put Biden in that category, and a Republican Party that has moved further and further to the right. And I think the American public, at least much of it, remains in the broad center, but its views are regularly not well represented in our representative institutions because of the strange vagaries of our political system. Gerrymandering is a problem. Campaign finance is a problem. Because what happens is many politicians have an incentive, particularly because of our primary system, to take extremist positions to cater to the party faithful rather than to the broader electorate. And then they come into power and we see them continue to cater to the ideological extremes. And part of it, quite honestly, is fundraising. It's where's the money coming from? Which PAC is supporting which candidate? What do you have to say to get that money? And so I think we really need to get at some of the deeper roots of the flaws in our electoral system. You know, one issue, and I'll just throw this out there for people to chew on, is changing the primary system to a ranked voter system in which you don't have Democrats and Republicans in separate primaries, but you have them run together. So they have to appeal to a broader cross-section of the electorate. There are ways to fix the system, but I think you're very right to point out the fact that our Congress is much more extreme than our public. And I have to say, and I don't want to sound too partisan here, but I do find it very distressing that the Republican Party just tossed out Liz Cheney for one main reason, that she doesn't accept that Donald Trump won the last election. You know, so we now live in a country where there are alternative versions of reality caused by different TV stations and social media, where we don't have a shared set of facts. That's a problem.
Yeah, and in part, that's why I think so many of us value the World Affairs Council here. We take a lot of value in having these kinds of conversations, substantive conversations that promote understanding instead of just accepting what's fed to us on TV. Although, you know, we're all people, so I'm sure we're subject to that to some extent too. But I totally agree with you on the financial incentives being a huge part of the problem. And I think that's what Carol's getting to. She used a question mark. I don't think it's actually a question. I think she was making a statement. Seems to me we didn't want to be international to help other countries, but we were international allowing our corporations to wrest economic power in Latin America. Feels like kind of a similar dynamic. When there's financial gain to be had, that side seems to get its way more often than not.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I'm someone who believes that the United States does have an altruistic streak. That is to say that going back to the founding era, the American people have believed themselves to be on a redemptive mission, to make the world a better place, to make the world a safer place, to spread liberty, to spread prosperity. And I think on balance, the United States has tilted history in a positive direction. The wars in Afghanistan and Iraq have been disastrous, but they were launched with noble intent, right? We did not invade Iraq to get access to oil. We invaded Iraq for other reasons, but I'm not someone who believes that the hidden hand of corporate America is behind American foreign policy. It matters, it plays a role, but I think so does American ideology. And that's why I'm not someone who believes in isolation. I think the world would be a much less safe and meaner place were the United States to turn inward. What I'm looking for here is a role that the United States continues to play in the world that's sustainable, that enjoys broad political support.
Yeah, I have one more economic question, then I'll ask Randy's question here. We do have time for a couple more questions in the chat. I see Saul's back with us, so we'll get his announcements at the end. So the question I want to ask, I guess, is what's the economic argument for isolationism? Meaning, global trade drives prices down. Everybody says they want made in America, but they don't want to pay made in America prices. If we move towards isolationism, like, what does that mean economically, and how do we get the benefits of, like, how do we get everything we want out of the system, I guess is my question. How do I get everything I want?
Yeah. Going back to the founding era, the founders basically said, we will do better economically if we stay out of geopolitics. Because if we choose sides and we fight wars and we make enemies, that will get in the way of free trade. And so they believed that isolationism and non-entanglement and prosperity and free trade went together. And they were also protectionist in the sense that they wanted fair trade, reciprocal trade. They didn't fling open American markets. That push towards free trade really came after World War II. But I'd say two things in response to what you posed, Mike. One is that I think we need to make sure that the trade agreements that we do strike, and trade does benefit the country, and it does benefit other countries, it makes the pie expand, it needs to be more equitably distributed. That is to say, our trade policy has generally been shaped by large corporations. The big multinational corporations, they go to the US trade representative and they say, we want this, 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 and this. Who's not at the table? Manufacturing workers, farmers, service workers, small businesses in Wichita, Kansas. They don't have a seat at the table. So I think one of the things we need to do is open up American trade policy so that their voices and interests are heard. And I think that's what Biden means when he says a foreign policy for the middle class. It is doable. And it's important to point out that, as you said, you know, many Americans can now afford flat screen TVs and washing machines and microwaves and other stuff that they buy at Walmart and Target and Home Depot because of trade, because they are produced cheaply abroad and they are much cheaper to buy here at home. So I think what I think we need to do is find a more balanced trade, not to go back to a protectionist policy.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. There's clear benefit in trade. You have something that somebody else wants access to, so you make a deal. Now you get it. Makes perfect sense. I guess as you were talking through that, the thing that kind of jumped out to me is that it's almost because of the corporate influence, what's being traded is cheap labor. So it's almost becoming more about arbitrage than actually adding value to the transaction. They're looking for ways to take value out of the transaction in a way. Yeah. So I appreciate that perspective that you shared. Okay, so Randy Newnham, longtime member of the board, professor here at Penn State Berks. In a world where we are no longer the clear leader, and maybe we could even discuss that premise, what should we do about the problems like the current Israeli-Palestinian fighting?
You know, I think that the United States still is the leader. It's just that the scope of our leadership is less pronounced, and the degree to which we need to make room for others at the table is growing by the day. And you know, I made the point about China, right? That we will be living in a world in which China has the largest economy in a few years. And then it will grow larger than the United States. I mean, everyone should keep in mind, China's got 1.4 billion people. We have about 330 million. As more people enter the middle class in China, as they buy things and produce things, the Chinese economy is going to grow. I don't want to say that China is 100 feet tall and they're going to eat us for lunch. They will not. They have many problems. But there is a country out there that really is a peer of sorts that's making significant progress on technology and other issues. The other point I'd make here is that our allies are still our allies, but they are beginning to hedge. And they're beginning to hedge, number one, because we don't show a whole lot of steadiness. We go from Clinton to George W. to Obama to Trump to Biden. How long is Biden going to last? Who knows? Who's going to come next? We don't know. But I think the inconstancy in American politics is causing some of our allies to question our steadiness. And that's another reason that I think we need to find a more sustainable, modest brand of statecraft that enjoys the support of the public. Final point, you know, I think that especially when it comes to the Middle East peace process, we can't fix the problem, right? Americans have been trying to negotiate a peace deal. They've been trying to fix the problems of the region. And so I think Biden is walking the right line. He's talking to Netanyahu, he's engaging, but he's not really getting more deeply involved than that, in part because I don't think that there is a significant payoff for doing so. The fight between the Israeli Defense Force and Hamas will burn out sooner or later, hopefully sooner. I think the big issue to keep an eye on is the spontaneous violence that is now broken out between Israeli Arabs and Israeli Jews inside Israel proper, right? Palestinians and Israelis are now fighting in the streets, burning each other's stores. That starts looking very dangerous. That starts looking for like a low-grade civil war. In some ways, that to me, for it, from Israel's perspective, is a much bigger threat in the long run.
But in terms of our shifting influence, which you touched on, I mean, but he did call for a ceasefire, Biden did, and kind of got blown off. What does that say about our influence, and what other approaches do we need to consider if we're going to kind of lose that? I mean, not that they should listen just because that's what we say to do necessarily, but you know, maybe there was a time. If they don't feel that same pressure, what's next?
Yeah, I mean, the Israelis feel that they face an existential threat from Hamas. Hamas, after all, has some 30,000 missiles that have been hidden in various parts of Gaza, and they're launching them. So Biden, I think, says Israel has a right to defend itself. And I don't think that the United States has the leverage, nor has it really ever had the leverage to step right in and say, stop that fighting, get out of Lebanon, get out of the West Bank. What I do think it can do and should do is, once the bloodshed stops and the fighting stops, to try to create a longer term platform for lasting peace. Because the status quo in that region is not tenable in the long run, right? You can't have Israel occupying large parts of the West Bank and Gaza forever. There needs to be some political resolution. That's where I think the United States, working with other partners, can play an important role.
All right, I think we're going to start to wrap up here. I do have, I guess it's not a question, but I'll read it to you for comment from Paul Ho, a member here in chat. Talks about isolationism versus internationalism is one way to look at the issues. Idealism versus realism is another complementary way to pose the issue. And he references a book, Realism versus Idealism in American Foreign Policy by Dr. Osgood from the 50s, and says it's not mutually exclusive of course, but rather a balanced view. Any comments on the idea of idealism versus realism in this context?
Yeah, I mean, I think that idealism versus realism courses through the history that we've been talking about, and it doesn't really dictate either isolationism or realism, in the sense that Americans were very idealistic during the 19th century, but isolationists. They just wanted to serve as an exemplar, and they thought that they needed to perfect their experiment at home rather than worry about exporting it abroad. After the bombing of Pearl Harbor, because of concern about security, we took a more realist approach to the projection of power, but remained quite idealist. I think, though, that we did trip ourselves on our idealism after the fall of the Berlin Wall. I think we did create a set of circumstances that I would call overreach by believing that we won, that history was ending, that China, Russia, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, all of these countries around the world were going to dock in our harbor, that they were going to follow the American trajectory. And it set a bunch of expectations in train that I do think led to overreach and set up a situation where Trump came along and said, I hear you, and I'm going to put things right again. So right now, I think we need strong a strong mix of idealism and realism. And so when I say, let's not call this a battle between democracy and autocracy, I'm not saying let's just be realists about this, but I am saying that let's expose our idealist ambitions to a strong dose of realism, because quite honestly, that's the role that other countries are playing. I mean, the Chinese are realists par excellence. They are mercantilists par excellence. We need to understand that and temper our idealism with a strong realist streak.
Thank you so much for joining us here today. I've really enjoyed speaking with you. I'm going to, on behalf of our members, say that we really enjoyed and got a lot out of the conversation. Before I bring Saul back on, I will wrap up with one last question. What is the best piece of foreign policy news that you have heard recently? Where are you most optimistic?
I would say that the best piece of foreign policy news is to some extent what's happening to us and our democratic allies. That is to say that, you know, we've lived through a scary period in history. I never thought I'd live through 4 years similar to the 4 years we've been through. I never thought I'd witness in our European allies strong streaks of populism, of illiberalism, of countries that are prepared to take their constitutional laws and rule and chuck them out the window, right? And I began to ask myself, have we passed through the high watermark of liberal democracy? Are we going to be living in a more illiberal and a more racist and a more dangerous world? And I think that the pendulum has begun to swing back in a better direction. I think I can be more optimistic now about this experiment in liberal democracy and decency that the United States has led since 1789, that this experiment is going to make it. But I do think that that's why our priorities have to be here at home. We need to fix the causes of discontent. We need to fix the causes of illiberalism. We need to address, to put it bluntly, the future of work. In the digital era, what are Americans going to do 10 years from now to earn a living wage? Right? You used to make $30 an hour working on a GM production line. If you work today at Walmart, the largest employer in the country, you're making around $8 an hour. I don't know about you, but I cannot feed my family of five on $8 an hour. We got to solve that problem, right? If we don't solve that problem, we are not going to solve the deeper challenges facing liberal democracy. So we now know what the challenge is. We've begun to address it. That to me is the best news.
Yeah, the meaning of labor there. You just touched on a topic that is one of my leading issues. I think we're going to go for another hour now. I hope your calendar's clear. but we'd love to have you again sometime to talk about that even in more detail. Super, super important issue. I totally agree. And I think all of our members share that sense of hope. I'm personally still feeling a little, I don't know if skeptical is the right word, but I would like to see. Yeah, it'd be nice to see some of this voting rights stuff get through. But we'll keep an eye on that. Thanks again for coming to chat with me today, Charles.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for hosting me. I've enjoyed it.
Awesome. Thanks. And now to wrap up the meeting, it looks like we've got him here on the line, Dr. Saul Lausch.
Yeah. I apologize. My internet connection just dropped on me. And sorry about that. But thank you, Dr. Kupchan. And while I'm thinking to say this, would you please, we have a small gift for you from a locally crafted artist. We want to send it to you. Could you send to Mike and or David an address where we could send that?
It'd be my pleasure.
One way of saying thank you. If you'll do that, we would appreciate it. Upcoming, folks, and Dr. Kupchan, you might be interested in how we go about some of our things. June 9, we have a different kind of program, as I started to say before I dropped. We're going to be highlighting some of these students, high school students, who have been recipients of our Alan Miller Scholarship Fund program. And we think you'll find it very interesting, including announcing the three students who this year are going to be receiving some of the scholarship money. But learning about those students, some of them who've gone on, where are they now after a couple of years? What are they doing? Very interesting time, and we hope you all can join us. June 9 at noon, that's a Wednesday. June 22, we have with us Dr. Timothy Medianic. He will be speaking on Ukraine from a personal perspective. He was scheduled with us a year ago until the crash we had with COVID. He is a local dentist, but came here to the United States at age 15. And he is one of 10 children, and they emigrated when he was 13, actually. He is a graduate of Messiah College and the Temple University of Dentistry. He will present his assessment of the current situation in the Ukraine, certainly from a personal perspective. He has twice returned there and has been blocked because of COVID from returning again to perform dental services in orphanages and also to the Ukrainian military. So we think it'll be an interesting, different kind of program, and we welcome you to that. And then July 14 at noon, Rebecca Pincus will be speaking to us about emerging great power competition in the Arctic, certainly a topic we have not yet ventured into very much. Ms. Pincus is assistant professor in the Strategic and Operational Research Department, SWORD, in the Center for Naval Warfare Studies at the U.S. Naval War College, and is a member of the Institute for Future Warfare Studies within SWORD. She previously served as primary investigator at the U.S. Coast Guard's Center for Arctic Study and Policy, located at the U.S. Coast Guard Academy. A very interesting topic for us, again, a different one. So we hope, folks, that you find these three upcoming programs to your liking. Thank you again, Dr. Kupchan, for your very welcome and very insightful presentation to us today. We very much appreciate it.
It's been my pleasure.
Okay, good day, everyone.
Bye-bye.